Welcome to the NLC Prep History of Surveying playlist. I've always told people, you know, surveyors are like half detective with that one foot in history and the other half computer mad scientist with one foot in the future. Well, this playlist is all about the past, and I love it. We're going to give you a glimpse into Egypt, Rome, Old England, surveying in colonial America. It's going to be great. This is my favorite playlist so far. So watch a few videos, and if you enjoy it, hit the thumbs up button, and don't forget to hit subscribe and click that bell. Now that we've gone through Egypt and how they basically only had a single rope to make all of their surveying measurements, let's fast forward to another civilization, and the civilization is Greece. And the Greeks were brainiacs, you know, they were the central point of knowledge. The thinkers, the great thinkers, lived in Greece. And the Greeks are not very famous for their surveying instruments because the Greeks are more theoretical than they are practical. But the theoretical knowledge that the Greeks came up with over 2,500 years ago is still used today in survey. Now, the Greeks basically took the Egyptians' equipment and used it as their own. So the Greeks had their rope measures, and that's what they used. But the rope, equally spaced, got them thinking. And one of the most famous surveyors and mathematicians is Pythagoras. Now, Pythagoras really was not a field surveyor, but he did come up with many of the formulas, like the Pythagorean theorem, which we've used for over 2,500 years. And this knowledge base set the tone for surveying for two centuries to come. Why? Because Pythagoras loved geometry. And he loved geometry so much that he went to Egypt to learn all about the Egyptians' geometry. Think right triangles. And when he came back to Greece, he brought the Egyptian right triangle idea, as well as his own ideas in later decades. Pythagoras really should be considered one of the ancient grandfathers of survey. Another side note here is some of the units that the Greeks used. As we know, you know, we have the cubit, we have the fathom, the foot, the inch. All of these are ancient units. And the one thing that ancient units have in common is they are all related to the human body. Example, the digits of a finger. The links of two fingers is called a conlos. The links of eight fingers is called a dichos. The length of 16 digits or fingers is called a pous or a foot. And many of these measurements, or some of them I should say at least, are still used today. The foot is a great example. But what's important to remember is that the ancient civilizations, Greeks, Romans, Egyptians, whoever, they all based their units of measure off of physical things. You know, a boulder the size of whatever is the unit of a ton. The 16 digits added up is a foot. A cubit is the span of one arm length to whatever. Another important part of ancient Greece is their idea of the base 10 system. We take it for granted that if you add a zero to any number, it makes it into the next exponential number. So 10, 100, 1,000, 10,000, whatever, because this makes adding and subtracting and multiplying and dividing very simple. But up until this point, the units of measure were not that intuitive. And it took the Greeks and later the Romans to build this base 10 system. Now, I'm still trying to teach my 9-year-old how to multiply by 10 and 100, which is an uphill journey, but I guarantee you it makes the math easier. And as we do that, we've basically adopted a system from Attic and other civilizations, but the Greeks perfected it. Because remember, the Greeks are the mathematicians of the ancient world. So when you go to add or subtract or multiply, thank Pythagoras and his friends for all the help on the base 10. But be careful, because some places, like gons and grads for European angle measurement, do not use the base 10 system. They may use a base 8 or a base 6 or whatever, so just don't take our system of measurement quite for granted. Another grandfather of surveying is Euclid of Alexandria. Euclid of Alexandria was a Greek mathematician who, I've always thought Pythagoras was the founder of geometry, but really it was Euclid around, say, 400, 300 BC, who is the father of geometry. And his most influential work, called The Elements, is and was the main textbook for teaching geometry all the way up until the 20th century. So for 2,000 plus years, his book, edited obviously, but still his book, was the foundation for all geometry. Now we also have a special branch of geometry called Euclidean geometry. And this has to deal with perspective, conic sections. Also, do you like spherical triangles? I hate those suckers. He's the one that came up with it. And he is one of the most important figures in ancient Greece and the entire ancient world for mathematics. Again, here's Pythagoras. Pythagoras is best known for the Pythagorean theorem. I just ran a FSPS prep course last week, and we used the Pythagorean theorem a ton to solve for the missing distance of a triangle. Remember, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. Now, according to popular legend, he discovered the Pythagorean theorem when he was sacrificing an ox to the gods. Now, I have no idea how you discover the Pythagorean theorem while sacrificing an ox, but that's what all the history books say. And finally, our last person, the trifecta of Greek mathematicians, is Archimedes. And I think Archimedes is probably the most fascinating person, because Archimedes was not just a mathematician. He was also a scientist, and he came up with lots of really cool inventions. But Archimedes developed pi, or an approximation of pi. And he also came up with different geometrical theorems of a circle, of an ellipse, of a surface area, a volume, and also he really came up with the precursor to calculus. For many years, I absolutely hated calculus, so I have a hard time, respecting this guy initially. But Archimedes came up with an approximation of the area under a parabola. And if you remember your calculus class from college, the whole point of an integral is to get infinitesimally small areas under a parabola. So before the mathematicians really had the brain power to do an integral, they used Archimedes' back door to come up with this area. In my opinion, Euclid and Pythagoras were theoretical mathematicians. But Archimedes used his mathematics to found both hydrostatics and statics, two branches of engineering. So I think of Archimedes as an engineer who used mathematics for his own ends, as opposed to a pure mathematician, which is mostly Euclid and Pythagoras. One of the coolest things Archimedes did was to create what's called the Archimedes screw. And the Archimedes screw was used to transport water uphill. And it seems simple. Imagine seeing one of these suckers in the ancient world, 2,500 years ago, and it'll really blow your mind.